It's Friday, August 21st, 2020. I'm Greg Nibbler, and this is Digital Trends Live. Yes, indeed. Hello, everyone. This is Digital Trends Live. I am Greg Nibbler, and thank you for being here. Wherever you are, we appreciate it. Of course, we're broadcast live here every single weekday, 9 a.m. Pacific, noon Eastern, bringing you trending tech headlines, news, interviews, discussions, and more. So hit subscribe, share the show, let other people know about it, and let's get you started off with some tech news right now. After Lyft threatened to shutter its ride-sharing doors by Thursday night, a California judge has granted both them and Uber a reprieve from the labor law AB 5 for now. So Uber and Lyft have both been contesting the enactment of this law since before it was even officially passed in early January. The deadline to reclassify their drivers as employees instead of contractors was imminent due to an injunction that had been placed on them. So the classification would make drivers eligible for a minimum wage, social security, time off, and other benefits associated with regular employment. So the late reprieve extends the moratorium on enforcing the statute until at least mid-October. Now at the same time, there's another bill on the ballot called Proposition 22. This would essentially reverse Assembly Bill 5 and let the companies officially continue business as usual. So Lyft and Uber have both argued that AB 5 would be detrimental to their businesses and for their drivers, with Lyft implying that 80 to 90% of Californians who earn money on gig economy apps would lose out on their ability to do so. So the extra stay on the enforcement will also allow the two companies to pursue the possibility of turning their operations in California over to fleet companies, which would separate them from the responsibility of overseeing drivers while still providing software an application. There is a lot that can change between now and October. It's definitely a rapidly changing story. Whatever happens with this will have ramifications elsewhere, but you'll want to follow along with all of it at digitaltrends.com. So, while Apple continues to fight against Epic Games, its App Store showdown appears to now be expanding to major news publishers, as a group of them is pushing back against the company's terms and conditions. So publishers like the New York Times, Washington Post, Vox Media, all of those belong to an association called Digital Content Next, which sent a letter to Apple CEO Tim Cook asking what would be necessary for their group to negotiate a similar deal to Amazon's for the App Store. So, context, Apple generally takes a 30% cut of all in-app purchases in its store, and that includes news subscriptions. So after an individual subscriber has been paying for a year, Apple then reduces the take to 15%. However, after the antitrust hearings that just took place, it was revealed that Amazon has had a separate and far more favorable deal going with Apple since 2016. So a letter from an Apple executive, Eddie Q, was sent to Jeff Bezos and showed that the Prime Video app has a standing cut of only 15% regardless of when someone subscribes. That's a big difference. So the letter from Digital Content Next asks specifically what kind of conditions Amazon met that allowed for such a deal to be arranged and what they could do to meet those requirements. So this is probably not an original email there to Amazon that Apple really wanted to be made public, but the issue of favorable deals to some and not others really goes to the crux of the antitrust investigation and the accusation that Apple's essentially suppressing some competition and not others. So there's no word yet on Apple's official response, but it's probably not a bold prediction to say that other companies in other industries may start openly questioning Apple as well, along the lines of Epic Games, and who knows what else is next in this. But you can read more about it at digitaltrends.com. Continuing with Apple. Apple may have just accidentally told everyone when they're going to be holding the release event for the new iPhone 12. So for a quick minute, on Thursday, August 20th, Apple's YouTube channel sent out a broadcast test feed that went live to everyone subscribed to the channel. So the event date said September 10th. If that's accurate, it would be in line with the usual timing of the annual September-ish event that Apple puts on, and last year's was actually on that exact same date. But, of course, Apple isn't confirming anything, and previous leaks had already said that the date of the event may be pushed back into October. Regardless, we know a few things. One is that there could be some delays to the actual availability and supply of the new iPhone 12 line because of production issues. So, from what we've heard from their earnings report, we expect to see some new phones and some kind of delayed, and it just is going to depend on which ones are available at the time. But we do have rumors on what they'll be showcasing, so we think there's obviously going to be an iPhone 12, an iPhone 12 Pro. We think it's going to be the first significant design change since the iPhone 10, so maybe going with more of like a retro look like the iPhone 4. It's also expected that Apple may finally unveil a 5G-enabled phone, something they had previously seemed to want to push out, and that could be because of their change in chipsets. sets, which also could be a big boost for Apple. So either way, the event is going to be followed by everyone, and expect a ton of Apple rumors over the next month or so until this event happens. And we've got an entire roundup you can check out at digitaltrends.com. So the space exploration company owned by Jeff Bezos, Blue Origin, has had a big week of announcements, with the latest being the delivery of a mock-up of a lunar lander to NASA. So Blue Origin is part of a group called the Human Landing System National Team. So that consists of companies including Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman, and Draper, which are all collaborating on building the lunar lander that would carry the Artemis missions to and from the moon. So the full-scale mock-up will allow astronauts and NASA engineers to provide feedback for changes they'd like to see made. So there's three parts to this thing. It's got a descent stage based upon the Blue Origin Blue Moon robotic lander, which they're already building, plus an ascent stage, which uses the Orion capsule that Lockheed Martin is building, and a transfer element built by Northrop Grumman, and then software systems created by Draper. So the entire lander stands at about 40 feet tall, and the mock-up will live at NASA's Johnson Space Center through 2021 to get the feedback, with the goal of 2024 to actually send the system to the moon. There's some different test launches that'll happen between that, but that's where they're going to, is 2024 is the deadline. So, of course, Blue Origin also had this week. They were approved by the FCC to begin launching its array of satellites for its Kuiper Project initiative to provide broadband satellite internet globally. That would be something to compete with SpaceX's Starlink and other companies that are working towards that, too. So a lot happening with Blue Origin. They're usually pretty quiet about what's going on with the company, but we're starting to see more and more of what they've been developing. So it's a lot to follow up on. And as always, you can head over to digitaltrends.com to stay up to date. And here we go. It's official. There's no need to watch Top Gun 2 because an AI controlled plane just virtually took down a U.S. Air Force pilot in a dogfight competition, and it wasn't even close. So the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, otherwise known as DARPA, held the Alpha Dogfight trial for the last 3 days, where they set up and challenged a group of AI developers to create an algorithm as part of their air combat evolution program. So this 3-day event was the culmination of a series of trials that have been happening since last year. So these AI competitors were invited to compete against each other and an AI fighter jet program created by Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Laboratory. So the culmination brought 8 final teams in to compete against each other in a round-robin virtual aerial dogfight tournament where the virtual F-16s try to take each other down. The winning company was from Heron, and they got to take on the human pilot in the finale. So the ultimate goal of this program isn't really to put AI-controlled planes in the air to take on humans directly, but actually to have them work in conjunction with human pilots. Because ultimately, the military wants to build trust in AI-controlled vehicles so that eventually they can team with humans and perform tasks the human pilot can't. And that was evident in this demonstration virtual dogfight, where the pilot, who we don't know his real name, but the call sign was Banger, put on a VR helmet and went head-to-head with the AI. The pilot lost 5-0, saying that the AI utilized twisting techniques the pilot could not match. So it's definitely an interesting demonstration and certainly a sign of what's to come. Hopefully we work with the AI and they're not going against us. But you can read more about this competition and what's in store next at digitaltrends.com. Perhaps, though, our only hope of keeping the robots from taking us over is to get them drunk. So a team at the University of Southern California has created a tiny beetle-like robot that runs on alcohol. It's methanol, to be clear, but if this is the prequel story to Bender from Futurama, I think it still applies. So the robot itself is actually designed to be the size of an insect and weighs the equivalent of 3 grains of rice. And since it's so small, fuel's a big factor. It can't just carry that much fuel, and batteries are heavy and would only be able to hold enough energy to last a few seconds, according to the team working on this. So that's why they turned to methanol. They coated a nickel-titanium alloy with platinum, which generates heat and contracts when in contact with the methanol, and then goes cold and extends when it's not in contact. So they created this system to vary the exposure, and with the contraction and extension, they allowed the robot legs to basically walk like muscles would. It's a pretty cool invention, but you're probably asking, why do we need alcohol-powered insects in our lives? Well, insect-sized robots are actually of great interest to search and rescue medical organizations for disaster management. So the idea would be you'd send in a swarm of these things into rubble after an earthquake, and then they can much more easily and quickly search for signs of survivors and direct rescuers to how to get to them. So that's in part what they could be used for, or they could just bring shots of tequila to people. So that's another idea. But you can read more about this at digitaltrends.com.
Hey, I'm going to let you in on a little secret. It's now time for the product of the day.
All right, our product of the day is this, something that I think a lot of people are in need of, and that is home security. And the product is the Ring Video Doorbell 3 with the Echo Dot. So let's take a look at some of the things that this comes with. So the bundle includes, like I said, the new Doorbell 3 and the Echo Dot. It's got 1080p HD video. It lets you speak back and forth on it, so it's kind of like an intercom as well. You don't have to go out and talk to anybody, which, hey, even before the pandemic, I didn't like doing that anyway. So it's got an upgrade from the original Doorbell 2. So it's got improved motion detection, privacy zones, and audio privacy. It's got dual band Wi-Fi connectivity, so you can do it at 2.4 or 5.0. It's got, of course, the mobile notifications that you're used to if somebody presses the doorbell or gets into your motion sensor zone. It's got a rechargeable battery pack, or you can hardwire it as well. You can record all your videos for 60 days, share videos and photos for $3 a month, and overall have some really good access to security measures while you're working there at home. So this is, like I said, the product of the day, and with that, it is on sale. So as you can see right here, if you click that link just below me, you can go and take advantage of this product of the day. And the price is just over $200, so it's definitely something that that can save you some money by bundling it right there. That's why, like I said, it's our product of the day. So click that link, whether it's below me, to the side of me, wherever you're at, wherever you're watching us. All right. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in to Digital Trends Live. We've got a lot coming up. Devin Druid, 13 Reasons Why, is going to be joining us here to talk about his new movie. But before that, we've got Maya Schwader, who's going to join me for a new edition of Tech Briefs, where we recap some of the biggest stories in tech from the last week. And that is coming up next. So stick around. Back here in a minute with more Digital Trends Live. And welcome back to Digital Trends Live. I'm Greg Nibbler. Thanks for joining us this Friday, which means it's time for another edition of Tech Briefs, where we recap some of the biggest stories in tech from the past week to make sure you know all the details you need to know about these stories. And this week, I am joined by our guest co-host, Maya Schwader. Maya, hello. Good to see you. Thanks for being here.
Thanks so much for having me. Happy to be here.
Well, let's talk about some tech. So there's a lot that's gone on, a lot of battles happening this week. And first off, talk about Uber and Lyft. As so many. I mean, it's just like tech showdown after tech showdown, soap operas. But with Uber and Lyft in particular, so just to kind of give the context, there's the AB5 law, which was set to go in effect in January, which essentially would make these two companies classify their drivers as employees instead of contractors, which would mean they're entitled to minimum wage and Social Security benefits and all of that. Uber and Lyft have been fighting this. And then Thursday, there was the deadline where they had to enforce it, and Lyft threatened to pull out of California altogether for ride sharing. Uber was probably going to do that. But then a judge came in at the last minute and offered a reprieve, saying they have until October to kind of work this out. It's coincidental. There's another ballot, though, in November, Prop 22, which would also allow for the reversal of this law. How do you see this playing out? Like, who's going to win in this situation?
Yeah, they've gotten until October, but October's not that far away. It's August 21st now, right? Like, as I look at my wrist that doesn't have a watch on it, they don't have that much time. Now, I think I love the way that Wired described this when they were reporting on it. They said this was a brief but furious game of chicken, but it was a long buildup to this brief but furious game of chicken. Drivers have been sounding the alarm on the employment practices of companies like Uber and Lyft for a while. There are some grassroots groups that have sprung up that have been getting a lot of attention now, talking about how, you know, they need a minimum wage, they need benefits, they need a union, because they're being basically left high and dry by these companies. Now, the thing about Uber and Lyft, and especially Uber, is these companies aren't profitable. Yeah, they're valued very highly, but every single Uber ride that you take is actually subsidized in some way by the company. They've also got these other ventures like Uber Eats, which also aren't profitable right now. And you'd think that in a pandemic when everyone's ordering food and can't go out to restaurants, this would be the time for something like Uber Eats to shine. And it's just still not profitable. So these companies are operating on a knife's edge. They've got all these drivers that are furious at them over how they've been treated. And now we've got this situation of, well, how should they classify these drivers? And these companies really have zero incentive to try to actually bring all these drivers. I think there was an estimate they've got 50,000, Uber has 50,000 drivers in California alone, and it's one of their biggest markets. They really have zero incentive to bring these people on. As full-time employees, they likely can't afford it. This would involve, you know, paying them some sort of salary, healthcare, vacation benefits. But the thing that these drivers are saying is we really can't survive without these things. There's been a lot of studies about how much money drivers for these companies actually make. These Uber and Lyft will claim, oh, you know, it's an average of $25 an hour, which sounds great. And there have been some studies, particularly one in BuzzFeed that was done several years ago, talking about, yeah, okay, they maybe average about 25 bucks an hour if they drive for, many hours a week. But that's not taking into account gas, tolls, insurance, maintenance on their cars, you know, having to clean up after maybe right. a sick passenger or someone who leaves trash around. It's a big problem. And the thing is, we actually know what it looks like when these companies leave a city. Ask anyone who lives in Austin, Texas. The companies pulled out of Austin, Texas several years ago, and they had to scramble to figure out what to do. The genie's kind of out of the bottle. No one really wants to go back to not having these companies around.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I remember pre this taxi service, at least here where I am, was not the greatest. There weren't enough of them.
Yeah.
It sucked.
It was expensive.
So it is.
It was inconvenient.
Yeah.
It wasn't great.
Right. Yeah. And the drivers were crazy. So, well, I guess that hasn't changed that much either. But regardless, sorry, Uber and Lyft drivers. I should not have said that now. Anytime I take one, I take it back. But Uber and Lyft, that is their battle that's going on. So you can read more about that at Digital Trends. But yeah, definitely something that, like you said, October's not that far away. I keep forgetting. Time has no meaning anymore. But nonetheless,
what is time?
That is where we're at with that one. Right. Okay. Going on to another fight. This one keeps on expanding. So we've got Epic Games versus Apple, with Fortnite still not being in the iOS store or Google Play, but Google's kind of gone to the side of this thing. Apple's really been at the forefront of this. And I think it's because so many companies are mad at Apple for their App Store policies, which are the same as Google, but still, which is this, that Apple takes 30% of the revenue from in-app purchases. And there's a lot of people that have complained about it, but really, I don't think anybody's taken a stand quite like Epic Games, where they went straight at them with their 1980 Fortnite video mocking Apple. But
they were ready for this.
I mean, straight at them, right? Yeah, and then with a lawsuit ready to go. But Apple, I think they did something this week that really shows their power, which is they started threatening to then take Epic Games itself out of there, which could allude to taking Unreal Engine-backed software and other games out of it, which could completely mess up Epic Games. And I think that's a bold move that Apple made.
This is another crack in Apple's shield, or its dominance, I should say. I don't know if Epic Games is necessarily going to win this fight, but this is another chink in the armor, shall we say. It sort of is coming off of the back of this big tech hearing, this big tech showdown that we saw in Congress a couple of weeks ago, where Tim Cook was brought before the Senate Judiciary Committee over Apple's App Store practices, over exactly this question of this 30% charge, over whether they have too much market power. Now, Apple's argument at the time was, well, this is industry standard. You know, we're just following the industry standard, without really mentioning that they kind of set the industry standard. The App Store is so dominant in the mobile app space and the mobile game space in particular. If you want access to the iPhone market, you have to go through the App Store. That's the only way that any of this is going, that you're going to reach your audience, shall we say.
Right.
Now, we've got Epic, which is the host of the hugely popular game Fortnite. And if people can't get their Fortnite, that's going to be a huge loss of revenue for everyone involved. This isn't the first company that's come for Apple in this way, but they're the biggest so far. And it's bringing up this problem that's been in the industry for a while of, why is it 30%? Why did Apple set it like this? And the honest answer was, well, because they could, right?
Right. Yeah, and that's it. You know, they're kind of the standard bearer for all of that. So, again, a lot that you can read into that too at digitaltrends.com. And I know with Tech Beast we have to go fast, and it looks like we're somehow we ran out of time. But there is another another thing I just want to encourage people to check out, and that's with SpaceX. It's a little bit of a lighter story, but they had their 100th launch, successful.
Super cool.
More Starlink satellites up. Super cool stuff. So that part's fun. Space is still cool, but we'll see what happens with all these battles between these tech companies. Definitely a lot shaking out with that, and I think a lot will change in the next couple of months. But Maya,
absolutely,
as always, great to talk to you and get your insight on all of this, and we'll talk soon.
Awesome. Thanks for having me.
Maya Schwader right here on Digital Trends Live, and in particular Tech Brief. So hit subscribe to the podcast wherever you get podcasts. Tech Briefs is available for that, so go there, hit subscribe. All right. Coming up here, we have a great guest who's going to be joining us, Devin Druid. He's going to be here to talk about his new movie, The Pale Door. And it's a horror movie set in the Old West. I'm excited to talk about this thing. And that's coming up next, so stick around. Back here in a minute with more Digital Trends Live. Welcome back to Digital Trends Live. I'm Greg Nibbler. Again, thanks for joining us. Hit that subscribe button wherever you are, that way you can join the show here every single day. We get to talk to some great people. And our next guest, well, you know him as Tyler Down in 13 Reasons Why. And Devin Druid is now starring in a new movie called The Pale Door. It's a confluence of horror and Western. It's so interesting looking. Devin, thank you so much for being here with us.
Hey, man. Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
I love this confluence, like I was just talking about, where it's horror and it's Western. So it's kind of like two different genres coming together. And I'm wondering, for something like that, especially a historical piece like this, what do you have to do to go through to get into character for that? Do you practice like living without tech for it?
Oh, no. No, I think that because it's such a genre piece, I think so much of the movie is inspired by everything that's going on around the characters. It's more inspired by, you know, the character choices and the way that things are played are more kind of in the moment and based off of what's being motivated by the story rather than what's being motivated by the time period. So there are like, you know, some small things that you have to definitely be sure of. You know, I'm an actor that likes to ad lib a lot to make dialogue seem more natural and fluid. And a lot of times in like modern cinema, you know, you can add words like or different things like that, which you have to be aware of when you're doing a period piece, which is cool.
So did you have to learn any particular slang or different words that you could use in place of like?
I don't think so. No, we didn't learn like some kind of cool like revolver pistol like flipping tricks and stuff like that. Had to learn how to ride a horse, which was cool, because I haven't ridden a horse in years. But other than that, most of it was just like character work and you know, cool action stuff between all the set pieces.
Well, with this movie coming out, which is great. So again, The Pale Door, and we'll direct everybody where they can go see this too. But I wanted to ask you, just as an actor, You know, with this pandemic going on, obviously with production that was stopped for so long, I understand there's some stuff coming back up, but with that time where production stopped, did you find yourself picking up any other thing that maybe you hadn't done before, like cooking or playing more games?
Yeah, definitely. So actually, as you said, productions are coming back. I just filmed a new movie. I just filmed a whole 90-page script movie in 3 days last week. It's really, really exciting, and it was fun, and we worked a lot on it as if it was like a stage production. We're just like, you know, doing lots of rehearsals with dialogue and then coming in, and it's an awesome cast, and I'm excited to talk more about it. But yeah, also with quarantine, yeah, I love playing video games. I play a lot of video games. I got more into live streaming a little bit, thanks to my friends at NZXT and EVGA and Elgato, which has been cool. And got a little bit into woodworking. I got a table saw. I put my closet together because my girlfriend's been quarantined with me for 5 months, so I had to make some closet space for her. Otherwise, she was gonna just steal all my space. A couple years ago, I started writing and producing my own music. So actually, when we were filming The Pale Door, I wrote and developed this entire concept record that I'm still kind of fine-tuning for myself, and who knows if it'll ever see the light of day, but it's a passion project, and it's cathartic to, you know, make. So yeah, I mean, just delving into those hobbies and those passions.
Well, going to the gaming side of things, I just want to ask, you know, what games have you been playing, and what games would you like to play that you haven't gotten to yet?
Oh man, I still haven't gotten to The Last of Us Part 2. I wanna replay Part 1 before I get there. Let's see, I've been playing just a lot of Call of Duty Warzone. I'm playing with my friend Steve and just a bunch of people on stream, which has been cool. I've been replaying Insomniac's Spider-Man game, which is just fantastic. I've played that whole game like 3 times through. Playing a little bit of Sekiro. I'm like looking at my game shelf over here. I'm like, what do I have here that I've been playing? Yakuza 0. Yeah, that's been fun. Persona 5. A lot of Smash. A lot of Super Smash Brothers. My girlfriend's like super into beating me in Mario Kart now, which is fun. And yeah, just kind of cycling through all of those.
Well, looking at all those games, you know, that you just mentioned, and so many games that get turned into movies, is there any one video game character that you would like to portray in real life for a movie?
Oh, that's an awesome question. I don't even know. I feel like the easy choice would be to say something like, I don't know, like they're doing The Last of Us show, I think, but I don't know that there's a role for me in there. I can't do anything from. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I'd have to figure it out. I don't know, but you know what? I'll just be Sora from Kingdom Hearts. That'll be it.
There it is. Okay, I wanted to ask just a couple more things too, because I know, you know, with 13 Reasons Why wrapping up. And, you know, with that fourth season that came out and just what a seminal show that was, and it took on a lot of different topics. For you personally, what was your biggest takeaway from playing Tyler Down?
I think the coolest thing about being involved in a show like this that was able to kind of be such a cultural phenomenon and have such a deep impact on its fan base was the response that we got from fans. I don't think I was expecting people to hold on to the message of the story as tightly as they did. And then seeing the response and people actually not only just watching the story and empathizing with it, but then taking the message of the show and continuing it in their everyday lives, I think has been super inspiring and has been one of the most uplifting and heartwarming things I've gotten to see happen through my career. And like getting messages from fans, or, you know, seeing messages from people who are telling us that they're struggling, and seeing other fans, you know, come in the comment section and offer themselves as, you know, support, or, you know, sending people advice or links to helplines and things like that, is just, you know, it's really, really cool to see, you know, the message of the show take on a life of its own with people who really want to take care of each other.
That's, yeah, it's an important role, and I think that's an interesting take on it, just to understand where it came from you, because it certainly had an effect on so many different people, you know, including, I'm sure, you and your castmates being a part of that. Well, I want to remind everybody, The Pale Door is available in theaters, on demand, and on digital today. Today, people can watch that. I definitely know it's a mix of two genres I'm a big fan of, so looking forward to seeing that. Yeah, it's I love these kinds of things where you mix things together. So that's why I'm really excited about it. But it looks great. And Devin, I want to say thank you very much for joining us too. You know, to talk about this here on the show. We appreciate it. And you know, maybe we'll talk to each other soon.
Yeah, man, I appreciate it. Thanks for the time. Please stay safe, okay?
You too. You too. Devin Druid right here on Digital Trends Live. That was really cool, kind of getting his perspective on all of that. And again, The Pale Door, watch the trailer for it. It looks like a really fun movie. Okay. Thank you, everybody, for joining us here on Digital Trends Live. And again, we are live here every single weekday, 9 a.m. Pacific, noon Eastern. But, I'm sorry, we have a very special shout-out that just came in. It looks like Mikey out in Beaverton. It is his birthday today, so we want to give a big shout-out to Mikey. And I hope you have a big, big day there. I understand there's some Benihanas in the works. Mikey's our technical producer here for the show. We appreciate everything that he does, seriously. Happy birthday. And thank you, everybody, for joining us here every single day. I'm Greg Nibbler. I'll see you right back here on Monday with another edition of Digital Trends Live.